Vertrouwen, openheid en liefde zijn begrippen die iedere manager doen huiveren. Toch werd de Braziliaanse topondernemer Ricardo Semler er schatrijk mee. Hij bouwde een wereldimperium op met de simpele vraag: hoe worden mijn werknemers nou echt gelukkig? Hij schreef er een boek over, Maverick. Een internationale bestseller in meer dan 35 talen verslonden. Iedereen wil weten welke toverformule hij heeft gevonden om met geluk zoveel geld te verdienen. Hij kreeg een gastleerstoel in Harvard, werd 2 keer uitgeroepen tot Latin American Businessman of the Year en tot Global Leader of Tomorrow door Time Magazine. Tegenlicht daalt af in de wereld van Ricardo Semler. Een wereld die draait om openheid, vertrouwen en liefde. Dit is wat u te wachten staat.
Ik kom uit Gentrifica, Colombo. Ik ben uit Samoa na Ficaria.
Sim, eu, na verdade, eu estou feliz quando trabalho. Você tem, na verdade, você tem que estar feliz com o que você faz. Porque se você não estiver contente com o que você está fazendo, nenhum trabalho vai para frente.
I believe that you have to trust your employees. You have to trust them enough to let them decide what is best for them and what is best for the company. You need to make them feel like they own the company, not only work here.
I'd love to upgrade the lives without downgrading mine, which is a different, it's just another way of bridging the gap.
Dit is Tegenlicht. Welkom in de nieuwe wereld van Ricardo Semler.
Zien we hier luierende Braziliaanse werklozen? Kijken we hier naar het stereotype beeld dat veel mensen van Zuid-Amerika hebben? Nee, we zien werknemers van de multinational Semco, die om 11:00 besloten hebben dat het tijd werd voor een moment voor henzelf. Dat ligt besloten in de filosofie van het bedrijf. Doe waar je zin in hebt, in je eigen tempo, als het werk maar op tijd klaar is. En dat begon allemaal met een idee van Ricardo Semler. Maar wie is Ricardo Semler?
Já faz uns 5 anos que eu não vejo, faz uns 5 anos já que eu não vejo ele.
Nunca vi. Tem 1 ano e 1 mês mais ou menos que eu trabalho aqui. Ele nunca veio aqui.
Ah, apesar de eu não conhecer o Ricardo, ter visto umas matérias dele no YouTube.
Muito inteligente ele, né? Já teve uma época que ele já teve entre o 5º mais inteligente do mundo. Eu cheguei a ver numa revista. Eu tenho o livro dele também, eu leio bastante. É muito inteligente nas palavras.
Você está feliz quando trabalha?
Sim, eu, na verdade, eu estou feliz quando trabalho. Você tem, na verdade, você tem que estar feliz com o que você faz. Porque se você não estiver contente com o que você está fazendo, nenhum trabalho vai para frente.
Niet alleen voor veel werknemers van Semco is Ricardo Semler een mythe. Ook de rest van de wereld krijgt hem nauwelijks te zien. En nu heeft hij Tegenlicht uitgenodigd voor een bezoek aan zijn eigentijdse koninkrijk. Een enorm landgoed midden in de Braziliaanse natuur. Nooit eerder stelde hij zijn huis open. Maar belangrijker nog, hij gaat ons alles vertellen over zijn systeem. Over een wereld die niet afhangt van harde factoren als succes en macht. Dat de toekomst van de wereld afhangt van zachte waarden als openheid, vertrouwen en liefde. Hij leert ons de kapitale kracht van geluk. En waarom dat begon met een gitaar.
Good old times, eh? I started getting involved with rock bands in when I was 12, 13, which was an enormously interesting exercise of freedom within the need of organization. I remember very well going out and buying the first David Bowie album in 1970. There were people like Yes, there were people like Led Zeppelin starting where Rolling Stones left off. There were people who were stretching the limits of that music.
Yeah, it's tuned at least.
Semler was pas begin 20 toen zijn vader hem vroeg om het bedrijf over te nemen. Vader Semler was 50 jaar ouder en wilde hem een ouderwets geleide fabriek nalaten. Met arbeiders die vreesden voor hun baan wanneer ze zich niet aan de regels hielden of hun werk niet op tijd afmaakten. Geïndustrialiseerde burgers, zonder vrijheden.
I come from this rock world rationale, which is I'm there because I want to be there. That it's hard to leave because I like what I'm doing there. And here we're trying to force all these people from all over town to come here, stand in line, and control them every time more with a time clock. So I said, no, this has got to be, there must be a better way to do this. So on the one hand, my question was, why is this such a bad job or such a boring job that these people are not coming on time and they don't look very happy? So if I put the two things together, we're doing something wrong. So either we just happen to be in the most boring business in the world, or maybe the business world itself is not able to find things that make people interested. And so I think my big quest from that day to this has always been to identify what it is that transforms people from someone that need to be processed in an organization to people who actually want to. And when they have their own drive and their own decision to do it, how does that change entirely?
Semler nam Semco midden in de economische crisis van de jaren 80 over. Het was een middelgroot bedrijf met ongeveer 220 mensen in dienst en het maakte verlies. Er moest hoe dan ook iets veranderen. En Semler ging rigoureus aan het werk. Op zijn eerste dag als nieuwe baas ontsloeg hij 2/3 van het management. En hij stelde een nieuwe directeur personeelszaken aan. Een pedagoog, Clovis.
Existiam ideias vagas sobre como é possível transformar um ambiente de trabalho num local agradável, um local onde as pessoas possam ser felizes, não só trabalhar, mas ser felizes. Geralmente quem tinha as ideias mais loucas era o Ricardo. E as minhas eram um pouquinho menos loucas. Ele havia sido roqueiro, ele havia sido cabelos compridos, etc. Ele já estava um pouco mais enquadrado no mundo corporativo.
Enquadrado?
Já estava um pouco, já tinha cortado o cabelo, tava, pá, pá, pá. Mas o Ricardo só aceitou assumir a empresa se a partir do primeiro dia ele já tivesse autonomia absoluta. E na primeira semana ele já criou problemas para o pai.
Olá, Guilherme. Tudo bem? Tudo bem? Tudo bem? Tudo bem?
Não, aí não, né? Só que não pode, agora é só um mole.
Não, não, dois, cara.
Não deixa o ombro cair, tá? Então mantém bem a postura e só vai com a perna afastada e os joelhos estendidos, tá bom? Ó, vai inclinar o tronco à frente, tá? Pode ficar olhando pra frente mesmo. Se quiser apoiar a mão nos joelhos, podem apoiar.
Ele não quis conviver com o pai na empresa porque ele sabia que ele iria romper com o pai se trabalhasse junto. Porque eles pensavam, eles eram muito distantes um do outro. Até porque ele era bem mais velho.
Mais próximo do tronco, tá?
Porque ele demitiu os parentes que estavam na empresa e pessoas que estavam ligadas aos parentes.
Tem que deixar o dedo bem fechadinho, tá?
The fact is that we've fallen into a structure where organizations and money are the structure which we have to be underneath, which are the umbrella of our lives. And that there is really no other way but to take your life within these structures. And there are some people who are iconoclasts, let's say by nature, who rebel against this. So they either end up in prison or they sell coconut on the beach. But it's people who say, I don't I can't do this. I can't believe this. And then there are some people, which I consider myself a part, which are the iconoclasts who would rather fight within the system. And being within the system, saying, this is not an intelligent way of life. This is not something that can generate satisfaction. And so you look at people in line waiting to punch the clock, and they don't look very happy, and it's very early in the morning, and you say, it's not possible that this is what they want.
Semco heeft geen mission statement, want dat moet je van bovenaf opleggen. Het enige dat gevraagd wordt is discipline. De discipline om de vrijheid die aan iedere werknemer gegeven wordt te kunnen hanteren. Er zijn geen privileges, geen secretaresses, geen vaste werktijden, geen vaste werkplekken. Iedereen bepaalt zelf hoe hij zijn werk uitvoert, zelfs hoe hoog zijn of haar salaris is. Het enige dat gevraagd wordt, is dat je op tijd je werk aflevert. Semco maakt grote industriële machines. Voedselmixers, betonmolens, waterpompen. Elke machine wordt op maat gemaakt. Van verschillende fabrikanten krijgen ze de onderdelen. En op een paar locaties buiten São Paulo worden de machines in elkaar gezet.
Recebemos a carta de São Paulo, que é uma pasta com todos os desenhos de cada uma das máquinas. Depois ela é elaborada pela gente com um planejamento e cada um tem uma atividade dentro daquela máquina para executar.
If you don't solve the issue of your context and you don't solve the issue of making it interesting for the employee or making him feel like getting up on Monday morning, then the rest will never work. The rest is just terribly hard work. And so we, for a long time, the only thing we asked our employees was, do they feel like getting up on Monday morning and going to work? And if the answer was mostly yes, then the company was in great shape. Everything else would take care of itself.
Sim, aqui na verdade a gente tem mais liberdade para trabalhar e para expressar o que deve ser mudado, as melhorias que tem que ser feito. Então todo funcionário sempre, todas as reuniões que tem da sempre, qualquer funcionário pode dar a sua opinião, né, independente se vai fazer ou não.
Começamos aqui às 7 da manhã, muitas vezes não temos horas para ir embora, né, e a gente fica porque quer, ninguém obriga. Então a gente fica por amor, se não tivesse amor não ficaria.
A participação no lucro hoje em dia é comum, a maioria das empresas tem participação no lucro, mas não da maneira que a gente recebe, né? O lucro é igual para todo mundo. É assim com todo. Dirigente, eu, ele, tudo igual. O que eu recebi, ele recebe de participação de lucro.
Semco's model voor geluk werd een gigantisch economisch succes. De transformatie van een autocratisch naar een democratisch bedrijf zorgde in de eerste 10 jaar voor een groei van maar liefst 900%. Semco groeide en groeide en werd marktleider in alle sectoren. Dankzij gelukkige werknemers. Want waar voorheen elk jaar wel een keer werd gestaakt, is de laatste werkonderbreking nu al meer dan 25 jaar geleden.
We have a few hundreds and now over the years many thousands of people have gone through the process. Some of them have not bought into it, have not believed in it, have stayed a while, and they said, this is not for me. A lot of people don't feel well with so much responsibility, because it's also true that when you tell a person that you're not interested in how much they work or when they work, as long as they get it done, to a lot of people that's scarier than saying you have to be here by 8:05, otherwise I'm going to fire you. But I think when you start freeing even these, almost I think the entire humanity, you start freeing them of this and saying, I don't care anymore what time you come and go. can you do this for me? And I'm not going to follow you around to know whether you did it. That the great majority of people will. And the ones that don't, that's why humanity is so interesting and so diverse. There's lots of people who won't.
I believe that you have to trust your employees. You have to trust them enough to let them decide what is best for them and what is best for the company. You need to make them feel like they own the company, not only work here. I really think that that's the best way to make your workers produce more and more and be more passionate about it. The benefit is that you make your work just like you are. The work is more similar to you, so it's not. I don't have to adapt. I'm not a person outside the company and other person here. I can adapt my work to the kind of person that I am.
Over there, you can see.
I believe it's a great accomplishment because the company now runs itself without Ricardo being here, with basically the same philosophy and with the same essence that when Ricardo was here.
I'm always imagining myself as someone who, as an enzyme, opens the architecture of an organization. And then themselves, the people who are there, they then structure this in a way that they feel comfortable with, which is not at all necessarily the way I would be comfortable with. And that's why I very much like the idea of trying to set something up and then go away. Because how people are going to maneuver that in the future is probably more correlated to what they think happiness is.
Over dat succes schreef hij een boek. En dat werd een internationale bestseller, verslonden in 35 talen. Overal ter wereld werd hij gevraagd om over zijn ideeën te spreken. Hij werd meermalen Latin American Businessman of the Year. En Time Magazine bestempelde hem als een Global Leader of Tomorrow. Hij kreeg een gastleerstoel op Harvard. In eigen land werd hem een ziekenhuis en een gevangenis aangeboden om die te democratiseren. En of hij niet burgemeester van São Paulo wilde worden. Maar daar had Semler helemaal geen trek in. Zijn overtuiging was geen trucje. Er moest iets heel anders gebeuren.
We were taking in from the schools kids who had been taught to be submissive from very early on. And were coming to us and asking us, what am I supposed to do? When am I supposed to do this? How am I supposed to do this? As more of this happened and as we grew, it became obvious to me that we needed to start earlier than the business. Because the business itself, we changed enough that it had some of the constraints were gone. But it was useless with a continuous influx of people who were just learning to stay within the box. So we thought, oh, now we need to go back. We need to go back to two-year-olds. Because already at two, we're starting to create all these constraints. So if we're going to undo them, let's undo them already in the very beginning.
En zo startte Semler met zijn eigen schoolsysteem, gesteund door een paar goede vrienden. De scholen worden aangestuurd door een stichting, de Ralston Semler Foundation. Hij noemt het systeem Lumière. Het staat voor een democratische school waarbij de kinderen vooral hun eigen interesses en nieuwsgierigheid kunnen volgen.
Schools are set up for the comfort of the parents and by extension the people who run the school. And that the essential object of school, which is to make learning a magical experience and to increase the retaining of knowledge, that is almost impossible within the structure that was created. And the structure that was created is one that makes it easy to manage large groups of kids. But managing large groups of kids is something that a club does, a concentration camp does, a prison does, and so that's why so many elements of these other entities are prevalent in a school. And the one which is to make it magical to discover new things, that's a minority issue in schools. So the structure is obviously wrong.
Tantas vezes quando fosse necessário. We focus on what the kids want to learn. We work with this feeling of to be happy learning. and want to learn. If they want to study, for example, the birds, I can teach a lot of disciplines through this content. I can work with science, we can work with Portuguese or English, but the idea is to make them think about it, to make them go looking for the answers. They are capable to find the answers by themselves. So we never give an answer.
Então vocês sabem que estão aqui hoje para fazer o teste do projeto do Gabriel, certo? E que nós vamos fazer as caixinhas de bombom, os bombons do Gabriel, certo?
Não é bombom.
Não são bombons, o que são, Gabriel?
São chocolates de dinossauro.
Chocolates de dinossauro. Então são chocolates de dinossauro. E para isso nós vamos definir quanto chocolate nós vamos precisar derreter para encher aquelas forminhas, verdade?
Uhum.
É? Quantas gramas tem a barra toda?
A barra toda, 180 gramas.
We divide the teachers in two. We have the tutors and the masters. The tutor is the person who's responsible for the student. The tutor knows what the student's been learning or not learning, what the student needs for being well. And the masters is someone who will help the tutors in some subject that the kids wants to learn. We don't have this book to follow. We follow what they need to learn. But what we know that we need a person that is capable to be happy in the world and be capable to follow and to learn and to have autonomy, to be able to function well in this world.
Agora a gente vai pedir sugestões de atividades para esse dia.
Het onderwijs wordt aangepast aan de interesses van de kinderen. In de overtuiging dat ze zich dan vanzelf taal en wiskundige en sociale vaardigheden zullen aanleren. Maar die individuele benadering staat nadrukkelijk ook in dienst van de gezamenlijke ontwikkeling.
Maar is alguém do infantil, ninguém tem nada para falar?
Voor alle gezamenlijke lessen wordt er gestemd. En de meerderheid bepaalt wat er gaat gebeuren. En dat is deze keer capoeira.
Capoeira! 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 Capoeira!
George Bernard Shaw said that everyone in their life only has one good idea, you know? And the idea that started at maybe before, but was impersonated in SAMCO, which then moved to other organizations, is just one central idea, that if you tilt at the windmills and you're a bit quixotesque about not accepting that the windmills have to stay as they are, it's hard work, but someone has to do it. And there are people doing this, of course, in many walks of life, but it's really the essence of saying, if you throw yourself at it enough, you can undo the anthropological structures which makes life so difficult, and which makes life so difficult to reach a linear level of satisfaction or happiness, etc.
White horses and ladies by the score, all dressed in satin and waiting by the door. Ooh, what a lucky man he was.
In de loop der jaren heeft Semler tientallen ideeën uitgewerkt, waarvan er een paar zo succesvol waren dat hij nu een van de rijkste mensen van Brazilië is. Hij is bijvoorbeeld groot aandeelhouder van het grootste ethanolbedrijf van Brazilië, met vorig jaar een winst van 12 miljard. Hij is voorzitter van de denktank DNA Brazil over de toekomst van Brazilië. En hij richtte de grootste milieuorganisatie van Brazilië op, SOS Atlantic Forest. Hij kan zich alles permitteren. Olympische paarden, tennisbanen, lama's, sigaren van voor Castro, de allerduurste wijnen en een hofhouding van 20 mensen. En de progressieven en verlichten der aarde zijn zijn vriendjes. Wanneer hij weer een leuk ideetje heeft, belt hij ze op. Of ze nou Al Gore heten, of Sting, of Bono.
Yeah, everything here, I mean, these were all... The whole area, this is much more like somebody's weekend home, but we wanted to live in the country, so we ended up putting in the lakes and many of the forests. All of this is man-made in the middle and then natural in all directions. And here, they say, if you think about the house, they say that, I think that when you have a bit too much money, you don't have an option to be eccentric. You have almost an obligation to be a bit eccentric. So I did my first architectural project was here. And I wanted the entire structure to be in balance off the ground. So they told me it's not possible and that it was going to give in on the sides, but it hasn't yet. And I guess when you're not formally an architect, you don't have to follow the rules, so you can always try something new. And I think it'll stay there for a while. I'm not even sure what happened
can I
here.
Help you?
I don't know what happened.
Wait.
I think I miscalculated the brakes. No, it's okay.
Yep.
I miscalculated the brakes.
It was about 7 years ago, and I was coming up here to the house from São Paulo, and a truck crossed the road by mistake. The truck looked and it was dark, didn't see me, and thought there was enough time or something and crossed the road entirely. And so I started braking, but the fact is I hit the last 1 meter of the truck. And it was a sand truck with a metal chassis, and it came through the car and it hit me here, and then the seat broke and then the car turned over. And it was a very interesting sequence, because there was complete silence after this. The car wheels turn, etc., and everything stops and it's silent. I was already in the asphalt on the concrete itself because the cover of the car had gone. And I was stuck between this car because the car was on my back. And then I passed out, and then when I came to, apparently about 20, 30 minutes later, I heard a conversation. I woke up because I heard a conversation of these policemen outside the car, and they said, no, he's dead. You can call the morgue. Just have the morgue send the car over. And so I thought, I'm dead? That's a strange thing. And I said, well, I'm sure that I'm dead. And I had my face was in this. It was all glass, and there was blood flowing and so forth. And then I tried to move my finger. And I said, I'm moving my finger, so I'm probably not dead. And then I did this, and then the guy said, oh, he's moving his finger. I said, but he's gonna be dead in a few minutes, don't worry. We'll just call the morgue. So then I thought about that, and I said, listen, what could be happening here? And then I said, let me try and move my toes. But then I'll have a good idea whether at least I'm gonna be a tetraplegic, what's gonna happen here? And I moved, and it seemed like I was moving my toes and moving my fingers. And then I relaxed a little bit, and then the car went down some more. With another 2-3 centimeters, the whole car came down. And at one point, they realized that the situation was different, and then they showed up with saws and electric thing and welding equipment, and it took 3.5 hours to pull me out of the car. And then I got, at that point, I got taken to the closest hospital. The guy took me to the diagnostics and so forth, and then he sat with me and he said, look, you have 13 important bones in your face. here, the nose, the jaw, the this and that. And I said, which ones do you break? He said, all 13. And he said, so now this is going to take a while. He said, we have to operate on different portions and so forth. And then he said, I'm going to take from your hip because you've lost your global continent, which is the eye has fallen. And so we need to put that up with parts of your hip. And I said, how am I going to play tennis? He said, no, you're never going to play tennis again. I said, no, stop. Let's find another solution. And then he went to me and he came back and he said, well, there's a titanium which has never been tested. I said, that's the one I want. And okay, so we put the titanium. And so he put in, I have 27 large pieces of titanium in my face. 43% of faces is titanium. But anyway, so the whole process, what it showed me was that, one, I was never meant to die in this thing. They, as doctors, of course, they say, well, this they missed by 2 millimeters, that by 4, you would have lost this, you would have lost that. But the fact is, it wasn't meant to be. But what it did for me was to realize that my life was at an enormous speed. I was busy, I was doing everything, I was on 2 phones, I was on all the boards and things and so forth, and that what I understood that to be was that it was time to stop and pay attention to the essential things in life. So I stopped for 3 or 4 months everything, which was just to pay attention to what was basic.
Yeah. 1, 2, e... Tchá! Próxima. 2, e... Tchá! 1, 2, e... 1, 2, e... Tchá!
That's when Fernanda showed up in my life shortly after. Basically, it came to mind very quickly that this is what this meant. And within 3 months after I met her, we were married, after we realized that we were going to be together and so forth. And that created a complete new microcosm. My father was born in Vienna, and he was one of the first generation of people who did therapy. He did it with the clinic of Dr. Freud. I don't remember ever having shown him my grades at school. He never asked me whether I did homework, didn't do homework, whether... He had a general idea that I wasn't in trouble because nobody was calling him. Once your mother believes in you and thinks you can do anything, then you can do anything. And my mother lost 7 births between pregnancy and some that were born. And so when I was finally born, I was a bit of her messiah, you know, I was a prince who could not do anything wrong. And my whole life, everything I did was always perfect. And so I had a buildup of confidence which helped, which I thought anything can be done.
Só X agora, né? Já falo com você, tá? Pronto? Uhum. Uhum. Santo anjo do Senhor.
Santo anjo do Senhor.
Meu zeloso guardador. Que a ti me confiou.
Que a ti me confiou.
A piedade divina.
A piedade divina.
Sempre me rege.
Sempre me rege.
Me guarde.
Me guarde.
Me ilumine.
Amém.
Boa noite. Tá? Dorme com Deus.
The consequence of many projects has taken me to this feeling, to this will, and now to a project of starting a village of the future or a living area that fixes some of the issues as they exist today. an area that affects all of the aspects of living together. And say, if we were to design from scratch a living situation, what would it be like?
Om zijn laatste en meest ambitieuze plan te realiseren, heeft Semler grond gekocht. Veel grond. Zover zijn ogen reikt, is alles zijn eigendom. Midden in de vallei ligt een dorpje, Mellos. Het is de ideale proeftuin voor het ontwikkelen van zijn ideale samenleving. En het is ook de ultieme test voor Semler zelf. Kan hij met zijn talent ook de wezenlijke en structurele problemen van de moderne samenleving oplossen?
How do you run this? What's the place of an environmental issue, a learning issue, a business issue, a financing issue of living together? And so this project has been moving now for several years, but it's a very difficult one to develop, because the easy way to develop is to do it yourself, and it's your own city, and anybody who wants comes to live there. That's not hard to do, but it's very invaluable over time. Over time, something where you are able to slowly bring people in, who on their hand influence all of this and then generate something which is not your own, is my experience with SEMCO and with the school and so forth. I think this one in particular has very much to do with the small children. And realizing with them very, very small that they're going to be stuck in some parameters of how their life could be more or less happy, that could be changed. And that if I could help creating some reference that could change that, that's the kind of perspective, because that's also the time period, 20, 25 years, that occurred to me that this would take to do. So it's definitely the small kids that brought this up, and it didn't exist before them. The whole project of the new city or township, etc., it has to be anchored on some attractions and some things that have economic sustainability.
Op de berg tegenover zijn huis is het eerste resultaat te zien. Hotel Botaniek. Bijna klaar, gebouwd en gerund door mensen uit Mellos en omgeving.
Tem bastante gente que não gosta, né? Tem gente que acha que ele tá mandando em tudo, né? Quer mandar no bairro, mas não é. Pela visão que eu tenho, que eu conheço ele, acho que ele só quer melhorar pro bairro. Né? A pessoa tem que entender um pouco, né? Mas tem alguns que não. Ah, isso que a pessoa fica meio revoltada um pouco, mas eles vão ter que acostumar um dia com isso.
The amount of people who are from here and have never done anything like this before is the great majority of the people. So the first thing is, of course, that it generates a whole economic environment around the hotel. It brings up the level of the people who live here, and therefore it will affect their family and then their kids and on. People who work there and whose kids might be studying it at the Lumiar school. And so it develops for this sense of place and for the township, it develops a cornerstone of an economic activity, which then makes it possible to start the other developments.
Er is 7 jaar gebouwd aan het hotel en de opening is aanstaande. Een hotel voor de rijksten der aarde. Het hotel belooft het allerbeste dat Brazilië te bieden heeft. Post-luxury noemt Semler dat zelf. Er is op niets bezuinigd en de prijs is er dan ook naar. Ongeveer 1.000 euro per nacht. Maar voor de mensen die er werken gelden dezelfde democratische principes als bij SEMCO en op de scholen. Voor nieuwe vacatures nemen ze gezamenlijk het sollicitatiegesprek af. En over de benoeming wordt gestemd.
Bom, eu vou explicar um pouquinho, porque eu acho que ninguém ainda participou desse processo aqui. É a primeira vez que acontece no Botanique. E a gente vai também, depois que entrevistar o candidato, que se chama Rafael, conversar um pouquinho sobre o que vocês acharam. Esse é o Rafael. Fica à vontade, Rafael.
Tudo bom?
Prazer.
Tudo bem, Luiz?
Tudo bom?
Olá. Tudo bem, Ana?
Certo.
É diferente trabalhar com uma equipe que mora, digamos, numa grande capital, como São Paulo. E você já pensou nessa parte de que você vai ter uma equipe de pessoas do interior? Então elas são bem diferentes. Você já pensou nessa realidade que você vai encontrar?
É, não é porque a pessoa trabalhou no campo que ela não pode pegar o telefone e ligar para o nosso hóspede que vai chegar semana que vem e falar: boa tarde, senhor Roberto. Meu nome é tanto, eu sou do Hotel Botanique, eu gostaria de saber se o senhor vai precisar de alguma... Enfim.
Voor de werknemers die hebben meegewerkt aan de bouw van het hotel, wordt nu een functie in het hotel gezocht. Passend bij ieders talent. Maar iedereen moet ook breed inzetbaar zijn. Leandro is in zijn vrije tijd capoeira-meester en gaat de gasten straks capoeira-lessen geven. Maar hij moet net als de serveersters, de chauffeurs en zelfs de pianist in het restaurant de kamers schoonmaken. Want een handdoek opvouwen, dat kan toch iedereen?
Porque caso contrário é difícil o serviço aqui. Muito complicado. Agora com esse hotel aí já abriu muito serviço. Já trabalho perto de casa. E daqui onde eu tô aqui lá no hotel, não dá 15 minutos a pé. É pertinho, né? Dando pra cuidar da família aí já tá. Tá de bom tamanho. Tá trabalhando, graças a Deus. Então, desse tamanho tá bom pra mim. Tô feliz, graças a Deus, tô feliz.
The question is, can you set living conditions that on a human level have the same level of dignity for everyone? So can I live in a town, in a city, where security is everyone's problem and is shared equally so that my walls can be destroyed? And the city is the final and the largest variation of how human beings find a balance between all of these conflicts. And that these conflicts are there, and you say, can I use money to distribute it in a way that is not anarchic, is not Marxist, and is not right-wing, which is each one solves his own problem? Can we build something that is a political, financial, and neighborhood situation that makes people live together better in this new world as we know it? I'd love to upgrade the lives of others without downgrading mine, which is a different, it's just another way of bridging the gap. I don't have even the conception that this could go wrong. What could happen, will happen, is that it will go different to what I thought. That's for sure. So I'm much more interested in getting it started and seeing how people are going to make it, so that with this thought, the chance that it's going to go wrong doesn't exist, because I wasn't comparing it with right. Thank you. Jung is probably the person that would come to mind as the person I think understood or completed or defined man in the way that I find most genial. Jung is always, I think, the idea that you're not alone and that this integrated consciousness and the fact that you're doing something which somehow is affecting someone else and that people who are thinking something together affect you in ways that you don't know, and that you accept the idea that there's a something that's not esoteric, but at the same time is completely untouchable. And this movement of energy and so forth, which is so way beyond our capacity to understand, that when I think Jung is one of the people who had the greatest genius to understand that that exists and to try and put words to it, to say that there are energies, that they're collective in consciousness that affect things that you thought you were doing, but it's not really you're doing. That car came out of nowhere, that truck that came out of there, that they're all there for a reason, which is not as simple as one white-haired, bearded God who's sending the truck all the time after you. You know, that there's something there, which could also be that, no one knows, but the fact that there is something there that is much greater than us.
A famous line from a guy who was a baseball coach that I think of every so often. He said, very uneducated man, he said, sometimes I sit and think. Sometimes I just sit. It's a very, very difficult thing to do, is just to sit, you know? Once, twice a day, I'll sit here and try to recompose what's relevant, what's important. After breakfast, I always start thinking about what are the things that I can cancel today? What are the things that I was going to do, but I could procrastinate, or I could leave for further, or I could cancel entirely and let someone else do. So I end up doing very little of anything that I'm requested to do, which leaves me much more time to do what I want to do. And with time, I think you get accustomed to canceling projects, delaying projects, postponing, and knowing that some of the projects aren't going to happen, and it's okay. Frogs. Hammer frog. Like the same pace as Haydn and Led Zeppelin. Hammer frogs are all the same.
Ich hoffe, dass Ihnen das Video gefallen hat. Klicken Sie hier, um das empfohlene Video anzusehen. Bitte abonnieren Sie unseren Kanal, um Updates über VPRO-Doc zu erhalten.